So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone presented here. And I would like to first thank OSCON Hyderabad community for giving this opportunity to present a session or topic here. So today I will discuss with you like automatic infrastructure with Kubernetes and microservices using Terraform. So firstly, I would like to introduce myself as they introduce, but yeah, so who am I? So if you are listening to me, then you should know the person who was talking ahead you, who is that? So I am Aditya Soni. I am SE1 at VCCD. I am Cloud and DevOps Enthusiast, Open Source Contributor, and Lyft Cloud Captain 2020. So let me tell you the agenda itself. Like if you are, it's my thought, like if you are listening anyone, then there should be three questions you should have. Like what is the topic is? Why you should hear this and how you will implement in your own scenario. So I will explain you these three questions today. So agenda will be like this. So I have just created a use case where I can see a live demo that I will demonstrate you with the help of Terraform. So I will firstly explain you that, and after that there is a lots of topics in the slides. I will explain you that they will come. So let me start. So brief about today's demo use case. So there is a use case, if you are a developer or you are any kind of role in the industry, then if you are in the IT industry, then there should be your work, you are a developer and you have to just put your code on the GitHub. So basically there is a GitHub repository and you want that code to be deployed on any of servers. Like that servers can be on cloud and that service on the private or anywhere. So you just want to deploy that particular code. So Terraform will help you to integrate that code with the whole CI/CD, I can say, and that will just deploy it on your particular server. So what you have to do, you have to just specify your requirements, your infrastructure requirement, your dependencies and etc. to the code itself, and that Terraform will do for you. So there is an end user, and that end user will just connect with that EC2 particular IP or that particular DNS you will just assign to them. So this is the scenario I will just explain you, but let me give you introduction about the topic. So there is a, when it comes to when we are deploying an application, then there is a previous methodology. What we do, we just deploy our application to any operating system. But now in the DevOps and methodology and the agile world, what we do, we just deploy our application inside the containers. So in this, first picture, you can see that there is a containerization engine. On that particular containerization engine, what you can do, you can just deploy your particular applications. Like there can be application of Python, Angular, JS. So basically, you can just deploy on that particular container and you can share that particular application to the your another team. So how that's how the DevOps lifecycle is work. So that's the brief introduction about this. So what do you mean by microservices? So microservices, let's suppose you have the application, you have the web application. So if your the application has a lots of parts, like there is a database part, there's a front end, there's a back end. So that wants to be connected. So what we do, we just deploy that to the different containers, I can say, and we just simulate them. So in the second picture, you can see there's a lots of containers. This kind of situation can arise when you have lots of application or your company has lots of project itself. So that kind of condition can arise. So in that condition, you have to justify like what are the containers or what are the application we have and how to manage and the load balancing also and auto scaling. So basically for this, we just use the tool Kubernetes. So the Kubernetes comes in the picture like this. So Kubernetes, as you can see, there's a shape. On that shape, there's a lots of containers folded here. So Kubernetes like that. So it will manage your container. It will auto scale them. It will just replicate them. It will do everything for you. So it's just a brief introduction about the Kubernetes. So let me just move to the ahead with the why there is a need of infrastructure itself. Like if you are automating it, then why there is a need? Because today we can see that there's a DevOps lifecycle. We just automate everything. From developer will just commit the code and to the deploy, there's the everything is automated. But why there is a need to automate the infrastructure? So when it comes to the infrastructure, it will just simulate the server setup, software, networking, hardware, and configuration. So just define these all terms, infrastructure will be ready. Let me give you an example. Let's suppose you have a small startup, or I can say you have a small company. In that company, you have just two or three clients, and you have that some projects of them. So what you're planning? You're planning to host that software, particular infrastructure, your own premises. So you will just create an architecture like that. So there will be application form for, there will be database cluster, and that will be connected by some networking like firewall, the network, the internet. So basically, that's how you will create this architecture. But let's suppose after some time, you have lots of clients with the different projects. Your startup is growing. So on that case, what you will do? You will have need, there's lots of hardware, lots of things. So you will just move to the cloud. But the same thing, the cloud will be here. Like you have to, if there's a client coming, you have to just create any servers for them, and you have to deploy your application there. But why, if this whole scenario will be automated? So we just automate our infrastructure over the cloud. So traditional versus modern infrastructure, like previously how we are working, and now what the skills we are just talking about, creating more efficient. So there's, I will explain like OPEX perspective. So there's two terms, capital expenditure and the operational expenditure. So these are the terms when whenever any company is open, or they just focus on these two terms, because like in the first scenario, you can see there is a picture of any data center of any company, any small startup or any company. There's a IT guy, there's an admin seated there, and this guy will manage everything. So let's suppose if there any system is failed or anything is just failed, then your application will be down. So you can't just rely on that, and your capital expenditure will be more. When you are relying on that, you will buy everything, your whole hardware, everything just you will buy. So this will be your move. But what if you just move to that on the particular any of cloud? So what you will do there, you don't have to just think about your capital expenditure, your whole hardware things. You have to just operate them. You have to just check what are the things I have to manage on cloud. So everything that is your own hardware that's available on now cloud, so you can just switch over there. So it will just delay you to the next. So basically, what's the IAC and why it's needed? So IAC stands for the infrastructure as code. As we just code for our application, our web application, or our any kind of application. But what if we just write a code for our infrastructure? Like I want a particular VM on the cloud. I want a particular VPC to be connected to that. I want NIC NIC cards. I want firewalls. So everything you have to just list down in the code, and that code will perform for everything for you. So that we can do with the infrastructure as code. So basically, in this, there's lots of benefit like speed, consistency, accountability, lots of things are there. Let me come to the next slide. Yeah, so if I'm explaining with the term Terraform, then you should know like what are the tools there that are already exist in the market, who are the competitor to the Terraform, and why Terraform is best, and why should you use it. So there's a term like configuration orchestration, configuration management. So lots of people are there who just confuse these terms. Like they just confuse Ansible with the Terraform, or Chef Puppet with the Terraform, or CloudFormation, etc. So there is a lots of things that are the different from these. Like we use configuration management to like Ansible, Chef Puppet, then our whole infrastructure or whole our base is ready. Then we can just provision our software, or I can say we can like, it's like you are just writing your steps to install the particular application. So it's called your, you can do with the best of like Ansible, Chef Puppet. But when it comes to the whole configuration orchestration, like you want to just deploy your whole infrastructure, your whole, I can say CI/CD pipeline over cloud, so you can use these kind of tools. So there's lots of tools like AWS CloudFormation, ARM of Azure, there's a Google Cloud Deployment Manage. So these are the tools of the particular public clouds. So they are present, and you can use them, and you can just deploy your application over the cloud. But so why Terraform? Because if there's a lots of tools, then why will you use Terraform? But there's a lots of dependency. There's lots of lack of these tools. Like you can use AWS CloudFormation for the particular AWS, and like there's a lots of things. But why Terraform? So Terraform is the open source written in Go and started in 2014. Okay, so you can do any kind of work. Like there's a lot of things like there's a AWS, Azure, ARM, VMware. So there's a lots of things. But what you can do, you can just automate your whole things by the one tool, Terraform. So Terraform, you have to just provide Terraform, like what you have to do. And the Terraform tool will do it for you. So Terraform, there's a benefit Terraform, like it's declarative. So you have to tell Terraform like what you want. You never talk Terraform to like how you will do. So you have to just specify like, I want this, I want this, I want this. So it will do for you. There's a functions like building, changing and versioning. So you can build your code, change and version. So anytime if you want to just to change your code, you can change. That will just replicate your particular private or public cloud. So there's the plan before execute. You can just plan. Like you have just list down the everything and you can like, this will just go, it just check on the particular provider and it will give you output. Like it can be possible or it will be through error or not. So you can do that here. And it supports more than 70 providers. Like providers means like AWS, Azure, VMware, OpenStack, etc. So it can be support. It already supports 70 providers. So what in Terraform architecture? So before explaining this, let me come to some part. Then I will just start with it. Yeah. So if you want to install the Terraform, so you can install it by the sites itself, like terraform.io. You can just go there and you can just install it. So yeah, so let me just show you this first. So yeah, so the Terraform architecture. So there is a Terraform core. As you will install the Terraform from the cloud itself, that it's cool. Or it's the main, it's installable, you just install it. So Terraform, the beauty of Terraform is like, it's plugins. So Terraform works by these plugins. That's a two type of plugins, provider, provisioner. So providers means cloud provider that are there or any of things that is providing you the services. And provisioner means you want to just to do some task over the provider itself. You just want to install any service in your VM. So you will just do that by the plugins itself. So what it do, whenever you will just create a request or you will just create a file, then it will go to the plugin itself and by the RPC, remote procedure call, it will just call to that plugins and that plugins will go to your client-based library. So this is written in Go. So there's a lots of things that communicate with the Go libraries and that particular libraries, that will communicate your upstream cloud API. So there's lots of protocol like HTTP, HTTPS. So that will connect to that particular API by this. So that's how Terraform work internally. So let me show you the commands. Like if you install the Terraform, then there are the commands, multiple commands like this. Like there can be apply, there can be destroy, plan, refresh, remote time. So what do you mean by this? I will explain you later. So just remember that these are the commands. Yeah, so Terraform workflow, like as I told you, like Terraform, you can just build your infrastructure, you can do anything, but how it will work internally. So you can check it here, like there is a phases of Terraform, like whenever you just written any script, then what you have to do, you have to just initialize the plugins. So whenever you will put Terraform in it, it will initialize all the plugins for you. And whenever you just plan it, so it will go to that particular provider and it will check. See that there is a, you can do
Hello,
these things.
Aditya, just yeah. I'll be stopping for you a moment. Your connection is breaking. So can you please check your connection once? Your voice is breaking.
I think it's fine from my
side. Yeah, better now.
So let me include this again, like whenever you initialize, whenever you put Terraform in it, so what it will do, it will just initialize the plugins for you. It will just go and download the plugins. Whatever plugins you just specify in your code, it will just download them. When it comes to the plan, it will just go and check whatever the requirements you have listed down. It can be possible or there is a lack of resources or there is a lack of permission over there. So it will just check that. When you will apply, it will just apply those things. And by destroy, you can just finish, or I can say, you can just destroy everything you have applied there. So there's the next thing. So how Terraform work internally when it comes to versioning, or I can say building. So whenever you will just put Terraform in it, it will just create a folder there .tf. I will show you in the hands-on also. So in the particular folder, what it install your plugins. And there's the two files. There's the file .tf extension, like any of .tf extension file. On that, you just written your script. So whenever you just put Terraform plan, what it will do, it will just go and check your .tf state file. So the .tf state, so Terraform actually record every state what you will what you are applying to. So it will just record every state what you have done before and what you are gonna do. So it will plan according to the, just by checking the .tf state file. And then there's a Terraform apply. So whenever it comes to the Terraform apply, so what you can do by Terraform apply. So let's say, let's assume example, like you have just to written a code and you just want to deploy it on your infrastructure or any provider. So you will just call to the code. So that code will be just checked by the TF state and it will just deploy over the cloud. Yeah, so now it's come the hands-on part. So let me start it. Yeah, so as I told you, like Terraform is working in HCL, the Hashicorp configuration language, and it's a declarative language. So here I have written this small script. It's very small and it's very proficient. Like there is the provider, you just include the AWS. So it, what it will do, it will just go to the AWS, it will check like to, what is the reason and what is the profile. The profile is like I have created an account on AWS and I have just created a, by AWS CLI, I have just created a profile there and I am including it. So that can be managed here. So there is a resource, or I can say resource like AWS, there are lots of service like AWS instance, AWS VPC. So you can just include these kind of resources here. So this is just a small example for deploying a EC2 instance. So let me show you my AWS console. Like there is no particular instance is running now. What I will do now, so you can just, see here. Yeah, so here's a particular script that ec2.tf, nothing is there. So what I will do, I will just initialize my whole the plugins. It will check this particular script and it will just initialize the plugin. So I'm initializing the plugins and it will download the plugins for me. Like there's a plugin of for AWS. So it will just go to the Hashicorp. This is the main, the creator of them, so it will just download from them. So it's downloading the plugins for me. So we have to wait until it download. And as I show you, there's a, another use case I have, like you have, you can just deploy your whole website by the use of the code. So what I have done in this use case, like there's another file, there's a osconf.tf. So whenever, when I run this file, what it will do, it will just go to my GitHub repo. I have included here, let me show like this one. So it will just go to the GitHub repo, it will clone it and it will clone it my any of the server. So I'm using Apache, so it will just clone it there and my whole infrastructure is automated. So I have used there like one EFS, one I can say CDN, there's a CloudFront. So I have used all the services there. So it will just deploy by this kind of thing. So there is a GitHub repo, I have just uses them this and it will deploy for you. So why it's taking time, I don't know. Let me check with bash. Maybe it's internet issue, so it's taking time, but it will just run. Let me check if I can do something. So so if there's a, let me show you this code again. Like there's a, as I explained to you, there's a provider. So in this, the big code, there's a scenario. So what I have done, like there's a resource AWS security group. So you can just go and check. So Terraform will do it for you. So what I have done, I just created security groups. Security groups, nothing but the firewall rules. You just specify over the cloud. So I have just created a security group, like I have given there. Yeah, so it's already run. Yeah, so what this do, it's saying like Terraform was initially initialized. So when it initialized, it will just give a folder. So as you can see, there is a folder just created. So in this folder, there's a lots of plugins there. So you can check them. So after initializing, what you have to do, you have to just plan your, you have to apply your changes or you have to apply your this file. So I will apply my Terraform file. So what I do, I will just apply it. So after applying, what it will do, it will just check this .tf file and it will create a .tf state file. So it will just check first tf state, like there is anything I have previously done. So it's created again the tf state file. So it will just check that. And again, it after this checking, it will just go to the AWS itself for deploying your particular infrastructure. So now there is nothing deployed on AWS. So what it will do, it will just deploy the things for you. Yeah, it's asking you to enter a value, like it's detected, like there's a lots of things. It have to create. So what it will create this AMI, it will create this particular host ID, IPv6, IPv4. So all these things, it just checked by this particular code and I have to put yes. And after putting yes, it will just create everything for you over the cloud. So by this small example, you can just automate your whole infrastructure. So for it, it will just create a EC2 instance over the cloud. But if you want to automate anything like this, I have just considered a scenario here. So you can do this also. Okay, so let me run that script also here. That big one. So what I am doing, I am just deploying that particular instance also. Okay, so what you can see here, it's saying that apply complete, resources one added and zero change, zero destroyed. So basically it's added one resources. So let me check here. Yeah, so the particular AWS instance, it just created here with the particular AMI. So that's how the Terraform works. And when it comes to like to that particular scenario, so let me deploy that code also, like what you have to do. Have to just apply the changes over the cloud. So this is my script for that particular, and what it will do, it will just create a particular instance, a particular S3 bucket. On the S3 bucket, there is an image I have just copied from the OSCON website itself. So it will show you after deployed, and when it deployed successfully, there's a CDN. That's I have used CloudFront for the content delivery network. So it will just use that also. So let me run it. So it will take a lot of time because it have to create lots of things over the cloud. So it will take a time because if we are provisioning our infrastructure with our code itself, then it will take time. Yeah. So we have to wait for it. So until it will run, let me show you the one thing also. Yeah, so it's running, I think. Yeah, it's asking us the value. So I'm putting yes. So what it is doing, it's just creating the private key. It's creating a S3 bucket. It will create a key pair itself. So connecting to AWS instance. So it will just create everything there. Okay, so it's uploading an image, as you can see. So I have just uploaded an image over the cloud, S3 bucket. So it will just show you after the deployed everything. We have to wait until it's run. And when it's run, it just create the files. Like there's a tf state file. You can see it. And there is a tf state.backup. So what is the save in this file? Like whatever the infrastructure is just uploading over the cloud, it will just check these files to the our particular instance. So when you will just destroy it, it will just check this file again. And after checking this file, it will just destroy everything. That's how the versioning works. Because let's suppose now you have the 10 clients and after some time you have the 4 clients. But what you want to do? You want to just destroy that six infrastructure or that six clients work. So you just apply, destroy, and you can specify what are the infrastructure you just don't want now. So these kind of thing you can do by the versioning itself. So it's creating a EBS volume. It will just attach that volume to my instance. So things like that. Yeah, so as I shown you in this picture, like it's just checked by the .tf state and when it runs after applying. So it's just checking the .tf state, like what are the state previously I was, and by the checking, it will just create my whole infrastructure to the provider side. Time it will take. Yeah, so here's a particular file created, public ip.txt, because my instance is running now, so it's giving me a ip of that particular instance or particular I can say particular server. There's my code is deployed, so I have written this code, like give me that particular ip, so it's giving me that. But we have to wait until this just sum up. Let me check this IP. It's working on now. Yeah, so it's test Apache page. No issue. My instance is running. Yeah, there's a two instance running now. You can check here. Like the, my first was I have deployed now. I deployed just now. So what I will do, just put this IP. Yeah, so it's taking time to upload these images over the cloud. So maybe that.
Hi Aditya, like you're ending your time. So would you like to take?
Yeah, just a minute.
Okay. Okay, meanwhile, can you answer a few of the questions from the audience?
Yeah. If there is any question, you can ask.
Okay. Meanwhile, I mean, till this setup comes up, we have a quick question, like a small query, like how do we connect Terraform to AWS from our local? Is it using CLI or do we need to add any roles to the local Terraform configuration?
Yeah, so basically when you want to just add or you want to just create your connect to Terraform to AWS, what you have to do, you have to just create an AWS account. So in AWS, there's the IAM. So whenever, if you want to connect AWS, there's the three options. You can connect via console, you can connect via the CLI, and there's a programmatic access also. Like if you want to include any of program that can do things for you, then you can include them. So as I have explained, as I have included here, there's a file called OSPwn profile, OSPwn. So I have created a particular user over Terraform and I have just added that particular access to that file. So that's how you can connect your AWS to the Terraform. And by this plugins, as explained, there is a plugin. So by that plugins, it will just communicate a particular, I can say, particular infrastructure to your code. Lots of time. Right? Yeah, any questions, other? Any
questions? That's it for now.
Okay. So it will deploy for sure. I don't know why it's not working, but it will deploy because it's created instance for the particular I just specified. Yeah, so we can sum up the call. There's no issue. Hi. Hi there, we can sum up the call.
Yeah, hello. Okay.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.